Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. You know, there aren't too many leading ladies in Indian cinema who can claim to have the kind of success that my guest here today has achieved. And at an age where most of us, if you'd recall, were barely starting out. And we'd see how she's kind of, within a very short span of time, grown as a superb actor, entrepreneur, and even now a producer. Before we start, could I please request you to put your hands together again for the National Award winner, Alia Bhatt.
Thank you,
Alia. It's your debut at the HT Leadership Summit, and we're very, very happy to have you here. And I had to put that National Award icing in the introduction because you're really fresh out of that. I believe it's your first outing after the National Award.
Yes.
I really would want to start by asking you, what was going on in your mind, let's say, 5 seconds before your name got announced and you went up there to get the award from the president?
Well, I have to say, I was extremely enamored and just so impressed with how well organized it was. And there were so many people from so many different, groups in the filmmaking industry, so technicians, actors, writers, cinematographers, sound recorders, everyone. And it was like clockwork, walking up and, you know, everybody was clapping for everybody. And it was just so meticulous. And like, I loved how well organized it was. So it was really very like overwhelming in general to be there, you know, and it's like a pinch me moment. But 5 seconds before, if I have to actually recall exactly what happened, is actually quite a lovely moment that Kriti and I shared together, because she was standing in front of me and she looked back at me and she said, I want to give you a hug.
Yeah.
And I just hugged her, and it was just like, and we both got emotional. It was just two young girls,
yeah,
living the dream and feeling a moment of gratitude, and with gratitude sharing it with each other.
So lovely.
And literally we both had tears in our eyes after that moment. And then we had to like get out of the hug because we're like, we'll start weeping over here, which we don't want. So yeah, that was actually quite a special moment.
Lovely. And you know, while we're talking about the National Awards, I think a lot of us also read about it, noticed it, Alia, that you chose to wear your wedding sari for the occasion. While it's also a very emotional statement, I'd like to say that it's also a big statement in sustainability. Nobody could have done it better to upcycle, recycle, whatever you may want to call it, your wedding sari. So what was there a thought, conscious thought?
See, you know, whenever there's a big event or a big moment coming up, the first thought is you start preparing for it. Okay, what am I going to wear? What am I going to do? And, you know, how is it going to be? And when it was announced on social media, my mind instantly went to, okay, you know, where is it going to be and what am I going to wear? And instinctively, I just felt like, I think I'm going to rewear my wedding sari. And it just felt very me, because that sari, you know, was thought and ideated, you know, done beautifully by Sabyasachi Mukherjee, but it was a lot of me, the yeah, white and gold combination and certain symbols. It was who I really feel, I wear a garment that I felt my most myself in, yeah, you know. So this was a moment that was also very special for different reasons. That was a different occasion which was extremely special, and this was a different occasion which was extremely special. So a special outfit can be worn for a special occasion.
True.
More than once. And I don't think I was doing anything that people maybe have not already been doing for many years. Wo kehte na ghar ke ghar mein ke shaadi ka saari pehen lenge ya wo iska sangeet ka shaadi pehen lenge beti ki shaadi ka saari pehen lenge. It's just a thing that for those who may already be doing it, they look at it and say, yes, we're already doing this, it'll just encourage them, yeah, that conversation more.
Yeah.
And for those who feel that, you know, for a special occasion, I have to wear an outfit that's not been seen before. Has anyone seen this or not? I just wanted to change that a little bit around and just say, look, listen, you can wear an outfit. I've worn this outfit. The whole world has seen it.
Yeah.
Like for, you know, days after I got married. But it doesn't matter. It's because it's the person that's wearing that outfit. That's what matters the most.
Yeah, I think the statement worked out beautifully. As you're saying, I would say commoners do say that, bhai ki shaadi mein pehen lenge, apni shaadi ka joda, and you know, all of that. But typically, I don't think too many celebrities, and especially those at your stature who who've gone ahead and made that statement. So it does seem very relatable to a common
person. Yeah, I think it's just us being mindful that you don't always need to buy a new outfit.
Yeah.
It's maybe the more conscious thing to do.
Yeah.
And you may not be able to do that all the time, but if you land up doing it a couple of times, it's a big statement to make for yourself.
True.
And for the planet.
Fair point. Alia, another thing that happened recently in your career was a lot of international exposure. One by way of Heart of Stone, which was a film that you did, but also by way of some international collaborations, like you took up the Gucci ambassadorship. You attended the Met Gala. Has there again been a conscious decision that being an international influencer is now the way to be, because we are all thinking global?
See, I think, like, for example, doing a film like Heart of Stone was a choice of doing an English language movie. Like, the year before that, did a Telugu language movie. Like, maybe hopefully in the near future, I'll do a Malayalam language movie or a, you know what I'm, I think the idea is to broaden your horizons.
True.
To as many languages, reach out to as many, you know, industries, get outside your box, comfort box and comfort zone again and again.
Hmm.
So that was the intention. And whereas Gucci and everything else, I think I've said this before, it's an association that I feel is most organic because of how much I believe in the, like, you know, I really naturally connect with the products of the brand. But Gucci has come to me because Gucci wants India. Gucci doesn't want me. Gucci wants India. And I represent maybe a certain demographic that speaks to, you know,
true,
a certain section in India. So I think it's only proof of how booming the Indian market is and how much anticipation there is to bring on the consumers from India to global brands as well.
So for instance, when you went to the Met Gala, and now that India is practically a growth story that everyone seems to be talking about, did you see a perceptible difference in the way now Indian celebrities are being treated abroad?
I didn't feel anything different. So I think that's the difference. It was, I was treated the way anybody should be treated. Yeah.
A lot.
Of course, South Asian representation can only become better and better. I don't think we should ever stop there. That can only become more. But like even when I'm traveling and, you know, there was somebody sent me a picture of a Mandarin Oriental shoot that I did for Mandarin Oriental in Paris. And somebody sent me that picture and I just looked at it and I smiled and I said, I just need to continuously keep in mind, no matter where I go, whether it's London or Paris or Met Gala or for Gucci to Milan or whatever, I'm always taking India with me and I represent that side of where we come from. And that's something that I'll always be very, I'll take very mindfully and be very responsible of.
Yeah. And this is particular of women celebrities, though I'd say that everyone has that pressure now, but all your appearances, not yours, but all celeb appearances, especially at international forums, etc., also attract a lot of attention, positive or negative, on social media. Not just the appearances, and you've been at the receiving end of it, but again, for everyone, this whole phenomenon of social media trolling becoming excessive, personal, sometimes toxic, if I may use that word. People have an opinion on someone's married life, their relationships, how they are in terms of with their other colleagues, etc. So it's come your way. And how have you, does it anger you? Does it bother you? And if it does, how do you deal with it?
So, I mean, I said this earlier, I've lived my life in the public eye. So I've gone through different stages with any sort of scrutiny that maybe I've faced. Maybe initially I was a little bit more defensive, you know, younger, you're a little bit more like, "Arey, but why are they saying this?" Maybe later on I was a little bit more dismissive, like, forget it, nobody cares. But I think I've grown into a person who genuinely feels that I have nothing to complain about. And I don't think it's fair, the position that I'm in, maybe the privilege that I have. It doesn't look nice for me to be like, "Oh, I don't like that people are saying maybe not nice things about me." I don't feel that that's correct. So even though maybe sometimes you don't want to read nasty things about you or your relationships or your family or your loved ones or anything like that, you don't want to do it, nobody enjoys it, but I'm not going to ever fight with my audience, because those people writing it, they're my audience. So as long as they're, my movies are doing well and I'm entertaining them, when I say I'm grateful for all the love, these are the moments that I actually have to show my gratitude. Not only when things are all hunky-dory and people are clapping for me, but maybe when there are no claps and there's a bunch of trolls, I still have to maintain that gratitude because that came my way. And I am here who I am because of the audience.
True.
So yes, I also feel it's important to differentiate between constructive criticism and just endless hate, because a person can just look at me and not like my face, and I can't really do anything about that. So I have to also differentiate between the two. But I also feel we have become extremely sort of subjects of what we see on that screen. I'd rather focus on my daily interactions with people. I've never experienced that any kind of troll up front, for example. No negativity up front. So that's what I choose to focus on. And if there is some chatter, I hope it dies down and you know, you kind of move forward. I'm at the end of the day, I'm a human being. That I'm bound to say maybe 4 stupid things in public, and people may make fun of that. But I may also say 14 intelligent things.
Exactly. Yeah.
But sometimes what happens is also kind of negativity travels faster than positivity.
Yeah.
But I believe in the larger picture. So I want to only lead every moment with love and kindness, and love conquers all.
Alia, all the very best.
Thank you
for
so much.
Jigra, and for everything that you decide to do in your future. And thanks a lot for taking out the time.
Thank you. Thank you so much.
Thank you.